We're going to take a moment to also thank all our partners for this fantastic event. Our presenting partners, Sony Live, We Live to Entertain, associate partner, Share It, AI and big data partner, Mo Magic, badge and lanyard partner, TimesNowNews.com, action begins here, and live webcast partner, 24 Frames Digital. Before we march ahead, a quick look at the partner AVs. Let's have the AV on the screen, please.
यहां एक स्टंप उड़ता है तो लगता है तीनों की उड़ी। यहां बैटिंग बोलती है और बैट्समैन भी। यहां फैंस भी अपनी बाउंड्रीज क्रॉस कर लेते हैं। यहां जेंटलमैन का गेम थोड़ा कम जेंटल होता है, क्योंकि ये बात सिर्फ खेल की नहीं, ये है इंडिया टूर ऑफ ऑस्ट्रेलिया। इस नवंबर सिर्फ सोनी लिव पर।
So ladies and gentlemen, it's time for our next panel discussion. And let me also inform you all that after this panel discussion, we in fact will be announcing the Twitter contest winner, the first winner. So keep those tweets coming using hashtag ScreenAge. Well, moving on, once again, I'd like to invite Mr. Sanjay Trehan, digital and new media consultant, who in fact will once again be moderating our next panel discussion on brand building on mobile only, if it's a reality or a myth. So let's have a round of applause to welcome our session moderator, Mr. Sanjay Trehan. And now I'd like to invite our panelists on the stage as well. May I please invite Channan Sahni, Head of Digital Marketing Consumer India with Johnson & Johnson, Jahid Ahmed, Head Digital Marketing and Web Analytics with HDFC Bank, Mahib Vivedi, Head Mobile and Performance Marketing with Flipkart, Shawneel Charles, Senior Vice President, Times Network, Rujita Nadkarni, Head Digital Marketing, Mahindra Tractors, Vinay Singhal, Co-Founder and CEO, Vitifeed, and Rahul Grover, President, Sales and Operations with Sai Estate Consultants, Chembur Private Limited. So we have all of our panelists seated here. Can we have a super post-lunch energetic round of applause, ladies and gentlemen, to welcome all our panelists here. And once again, Mr. Trehan, over to you, sir.
I think you've all had a sumptuous lunch, but I guess I have to earn my lunch now. So we'll begin right away. I think the topic for this post-lunch discussion is something which is very close to my heart, because, we've often talked about India being mobile first now, but really, in my view, mobile first has been reduced to a cliche, you know. Organizations in our country are still figuring about the paradox of mobile. They're trying to sort of situate mobile, in its proper context. Where does the mobile sit within the organization? You know, that itself is a challenge. Is it product? Is it marketing? Is it experiences? And then, you know, a smart CMO comes out with this interesting wine learner. Guys, we have to win in mobile, you know, without realizing that ultimately the consumer doesn't care. Consumer cares about the experience. So our focus needs to shift from winning in mobile to winning in experiences. So just as we are moving to a cross-platform world, which is increasingly becoming device agnostic, we need to look at how our marketing objectives need to be all about creating compelling consumer experiences. This is going to be the core of our discussion in this session. And those of you who have attended my previous session, and hopefully this is the last session I'm doing, so you don't get an overload of me today, would know that I would like a specific question to be taken by one or two panelists so that we can cover a wide variety of subjects. So the flow of discussion for this afternoon would be about the challenges the companies are facing in terms of creating and maximizing brand value in the mobility space, and how they are playing the catch-up game in the space, because mobile as a landscape is constantly evolving and the evaluation metrics are also getting constantly reappraised. So how do you win in this space in terms of key parameters? Is mobile content all about bespoke content creation, or can we leverage the content that we already produce and leverage it and adapt it to the space? So these are things that we'll be discussing. So let me begin my first question about mobile first. Is it a cliche or reality? And maybe Shaunil, would you like to take this?
Sure. Thanks, Sanjay. It's good to be here. So, when it comes to mobile first, this was tossed around 3-4 years back. All of us in the publishing business used to, publish on desktop, and that was our, main source of audience and revenue. And then this mobile audiences started moving to mobile really quickly. So for a brief 1 year period, there was a lot of chatter about mobile first, but essentially post that, it's become mobile only. We're in the news publishing business. I run a website called timesnownews.com. We're a little late entrant in the space. There are many publishers who started before us. So we've evolved in the last 12 months or so, and we're seeing 90% of traffic only on mobile. So even for brands who associate with us and who work with us as a publisher to advertise, on our platforms, our offering has only become mobile. So, you can advertise on our channels, on television, and then there's just mobile.
So what Shaunil is essentially saying is that it's not only mobile first, it's getting increasingly mobile only. Interesting. Now, that is essentially from a premier, video publishers like Times Now. Rujita, which you deal with marketing of tractors. So share with us your experience about, is it also the mobile first space, or is it getting there? Is it not getting there? Your opening remarks about how the tractor buying consumer is relating to this space.
Sure. Thank you so much. The space has evolved in the last 4 years. The journey began about 4 years ago, and it is essentially the mobile first space. Primarily, people use mobile to consume entertaining content for education purposes. They use mobile primarily for social media. WhatsApp is extremely popular. Not so much of financial transactions get done on mobile, primarily because of the lack of trust in such platforms. But they aspire to, go do online purchases through e-commerce portals, etc. My friends here would be able to get a better perspective on how people interact from the rural areas on mobile, essentially. But yes, it's transforming largely. It's also very challenging because the way forward here is you have to give localized content. So it's more about hyper-local marketing. You have to bring in the local experiences in your content. It needs to be more relevant and has to also be in multiple languages. So these are a few pieces which I bring to the table from my understanding of...
What has been your reaction, your feedback about the receptivity of your efforts by the farming community.
Sure. So what I have observed is people do consume largely content over like the TG, essentially being farmers. The age group between which farmers consume content is typically from 18 to 35. They consume a lot of video content. There has been a huge transformation in terms of lead generation from this community, which used to essentially come from below-the-line activities and van campaigns, essentially, earlier. So the larger proportion of spends was in that area. Over the past 4 years, it's moved to digital, giving equal number of leads or more in this space. That alone shows that people are looking for information on tractors online. People are looking for prices online. They today evaluate, compare information from how an X brand is different from the other. So they are making these, they're looking for information constantly. Okay. But primarily they use it for entertainment. So this has taken a huge shift from where it was 4 years ago. They use WhatsApp to transact business as well and share information amongst peers, etc. There are larger communities of farmers wherein they share best practices in farming from one area or state of the country with the other farmers in the other state of the country. So that just speaks volumes about how it's transforming essentially in the rural segment and primarily in the agriculture segment.
I think any broadcaster who would start the mobile version of Krishi Darshan, and I don't know whether you guys would be aware of the Doordarshan program, which was way back there in 80s or 90s, called Krishi Darshan, which was perhaps the most boring program ever, but very relevant to the rural audiences. I think somebody, there's an opportunity there. Okay, Vinay, let me come to you as somebody who runs, I don't want to call your product a portal, but somebody who runs an offering in the non-news content space, and the fact that 95% of your audience comes from the mobile, what does it tell you, and how do you intend to leverage this opportunity?
Sure. Thank you, Sanjay. Let me start by giving you a reference. I was watching this conference by International Advertising Bureau, IAB, and there was this very renowned speaker who was saying that if you are not thinking in mobile today, you're already dead, basically. So there's no hope for you if you are not thinking mobile today. That's how the world has become. Having said that, 95% of mobile audience is what we have on our 45 million Indians that we have. And even fortunately, we have global experience, American, UK, Canada, Australia, those audiences as well. It's the same sort of trend that we are seeing in those markets as well. Let me give you a context to the panel topic, which is building mobile first brands, or, you know, is it possible to build brand on mobile itself? I think on the client side, on the brand side, basically, and there are a couple of them here on the stage as well, right? Their mindset is also changing, and I'm very happy to see that changing lately. I just had a meeting yesterday in Bangalore with Paytm Travel. Travel as a segment is a separate brand for them. And it was such a happy meeting for a publisher like me, because we sat there and he said, you know what, I'm not looking for leads from this. I want to do a mobile first campaign, and I want to do it because I want to be there when they are going to consume content. I want to be relevant to them as a brand, and I think mobile is the platform where I want to build that brand, right? Having said that, as you said, there are those smart CMOs who are still coming out in the room and saying that let's be mobile first now. And as I said, for me, according to me at least, and not just me, but international speakers are saying that now if you are not thinking mobile, you are probably dead already. You missed the bus completely.
I think one of the key challenges about building brands in the mobile space is to change the attitude of some of our CMOs, because they still tend to see things in a non-convergent ecosystem. And now we are looking at an ecosystem which is all about solutions and not just about a specific medium. So mobile needs to be leveraged to create experiences which could be straddling many worlds. So just using mobile for performance of a brand will be only looking at one part of the equation. Let me turn this question to Maheep now, who's been using mobile in a big way to acquire and to fulfill audiences in the e-commerce space. What has been your experience?
So I think for Flipkart today, the majority of the transactions in GMV, you know, comes from mobile, obviously, like any other e-commerce has seen. For us, I think the key, objective is how do we reach out to more people? And today, if you just divide India into tier one and tier two cities, a lot of transactions today and audiences, right? We reach in tier two. The campaigns are strategically rotated on tier two. And I'll just take example of Big Billion Day. We had around, 47 superstars, doing campaigns this time. And the proportion of inventory, which was, split between tier one and tier two, the traction of tier two has been increasing, right? And I think we are going in the right way. And I think the traction on mobile has to be there. There is, I think, no other way that you think on a performance side or you think on a branding side, right? I think both the side, the first touch point to even millennial today is mobile, right? You, if there is a youngster who just passed out from a college, he would have enough exposure on the social media to know about what brand is, what is a brand, doing about. And I think that's all, with all means and ways, I think, this has been proven. So,
The audience may be wondering that why is it that we've straight away jumped into, how the brands are leveraging, mobile. There's a certain method in my madness. What I intend to establish is that while there are early stirrings of usage of mobile in this part of the world, and it is really hopefully going to explode, I would ultimately come down to asking the key question, and this is for your benefit, that is it possible to build a brand only on mobile? Is it, can we look at a world where, like the millennials have refused to look at newspapers? I know my daughter who's very well informed, exceedingly well informed on every subject, just does not read any newspaper. And she's still fine, she's educated herself because she lives in a world where the news comes to her and she doesn't go to the news. So there are ways where this whole pyramid has been inverted. Let me turn my attention to Chanan, who's been sitting on my right and wondering whether, it's going to be her turn. So Johnson & Johnson is a company which I believe is straddling both the worlds of the urban India and the rural India, and truly and effectively creating solutions that are meeting unmet needs of women in both parts of the world. I would like Chanan to sort of elaborate on this.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjay. Rightfully said, I think our consumers are all the way from the most premium consumers that we have for a brand called Neutrogena, all the way to some of the rural parts of the market also that we touch with a brand called Stay Free. And I think if you build out the common thread, it would be mobile, right? And I think for me, my understanding is, and like you say, how do you deal with the CMO question, is that 100% of people who are using internet are using through mobile. I think I'm yet to find somebody who's found internet without mobile, right? So I think for us, we were very clear that we have to talk to women on both ends of the spectrum, and if we have to build that journey on mobile. So we use the bottom of the pyramid to basically talk about, so it's a covert medium also. It's a personal medium. So it's only mine. Unlike a TV which I have to share, I don't have to share my mobile. So I can, choose to opt in and opt out much faster. So even the struggle for content has to be that much greater so that they don't opt out. So like I was completing the rural end of the segment, we are able to sort of sample using mobile. We're able to build a brand education story. We're able to show them videos that, sort of build, bust some myths that they might have, and then lead them all the way to actually sampling or sale through partners like Flipkart, who are also opening up their, doors to markets like Northeast, etc., where it's easily, completion of the full journey from education to sampling. And on the premium end, obviously, we have a lot of influencers that we work with on the beauty space. So those influencers are seen by women who are actively following them. Then it moves on from there to, you know, certain communities that we build, that we host, where they can actually talk to us about their skin problems, all the way again back to sale, where we are able to give them, combo offers, etc. Again, all of this is not how the offline journey is, but we've built it, and it's also not the journey on a digital ecosystem, but it's a specific mobile journey. And you have to think that. Like, I think we started by thinking from that perspective.
I think this is fascinating in terms of how impactful it can be in terms of changing lives. Now, Jahid, banking industry has been one of the early adopters of the mobile space. I remember initially they adapted the email route. You know, 5 years back, you were, and you still are, in fact, inundated by various schemes and offers. But now they are doing... They moved away from the app, that they developed a good app. Now I'm increasingly finding some very, very nice, responsive designs. Recently, Citibank has gotten, and I'm a Citibank holder, account holder, so I like the fact that when I need to check in on my app, it just does facial recognition. In less than a second, I'm on, no passwords or no OTPs to be filled. So share with us your view of your bank's strategy to truly leverage the potential of mobile? Or are you only looking at response generation initially? Or do you have a larger game plan for this medium?
Well, thanks, Sanjay, for this question. HDFC Bank has won Brand Z Award for the consecutive fifth time. And guess how much have we spent actually in maintaining or spend on media to make our brand? It's zero. Okay. So our modus operandi to make a brand is completely different. Okay. The blueprint of our modus operandi is 101 communication, which has been happening till date with branch and retail distribution, but that's not obviously scalable. So what is it that will make this whole thing scalable? That is mobile. Okay. So how are we using mobile to build up my brand, which is already at the top, and how can we sustain with it, fight the new age mediums, right? Which is no more the bank, but more of the Amazons and the Googles of the world, which is coming and fighting it out with us. So what we do is, I somehow love what Aristotle had said, that the whole is greater than the sum of its parts. Okay. What are the parts? Let's look at it in the mobile spectrum. Okay. We have age, we have location, we have the bounce off journey behavior. We have their transactions, we have weather APIs, we have traffic APIs. Now, imagine if I can personalize each and every word, the image of it, the content of it, make it relevant to you when you want it, right? And then show it to you, orchestrate my campaign, suppress the campaign when you don't need it, and then bring it only to you when you need it at that point of time. And not only there, I have to ensure that you complete the journey in the most seamless way possible. Okay. That is where our agenda is, to make it as seamless as possible via mobile only. And that's what we envisage to become as the best brands and the most mobile friendly brand. Okay.
So personalization is the key, and I think that's...
Personalization exactly, is complete key.
Yeah. Rahul, are you leveraging the mobile medium or the platform in the real estate industry?
So let me give you a perspective of how the real estate industry uses or leverages the mobile space. Obviously, you all spoke about mobile only and mobile first. Well, we represent a company which also looks at developers and the consumers who want to transact in real estate. So the developers use mobile only just to check the UTR number, whether they've got the funds. So essentially, that is the only thing they use the mobile for. When it comes to the consumer base, I think I represent an industry which has been tarnished or has not been very popular with the consumer, and it is not essentially a consumer-driven industry in that sense. It's always been very transactional. The developers have missed the bus when it comes to using the mobile space effectively to communicate to the audiences, because it's not an instant gratification kind of business, as you see. you purchase a home today, you're going to receive it probably 2 years, 3 years in the future. So which means it's imperative that a developer use this medium to sort of be engaged with the audience and the buyer and the consumer that they're going to be with for the next 5 or 6 years. Having said that, the question beckons is whether we can build a brand only on mobile. And I'm going to talk specifically about real estate. The answer is no. I represent an industry which is larger than life. If I'm going to show a simple example, an elevation of a tower which is 46 floors, I don't know what kind of content I'm going to build which can actually show that entire image of a tower on a 5-inch screen. So although I am kicked about the fact that an audience between 18 to 35 consumes content on Instagram, Snapchat, Facebook, or whatever else, I'm not at all convinced that mobile is a space to build brands only. Of course, a brand is much more than a business. It is omnipresent. It needs to have association with the customer. It needs to be at places which is not only, you know, restricted to a 7-inch screen or a 5-inch screen or whatever. So I think from purely from my perspective and my personal opinion, and also about the real estate industry, we have not been leveraging the mobile space effectively enough. And just to give you an example, a 159-character text message that we send out as an organization gets us more responses than creating the best content, which means that we're reaching out to a much larger audience. We're reaching out to somebody who has a feature phone as opposed to having the latest iPhone XS. And that is giving us a much better response. So for me, mobile today in India is still a lead generation portal or a, you know, or a medium or, you know, a platform. It is not engaged or it has not reached a point where you can create a brand.
Now, that is the kind of provocative statement that I was itching to have. I'm glad you said it. That mobile in India is essentially a lead generation exercise. Now, let me give you an example of what happened in the United Kingdom recently in the publishing space. People who are in the news industry would know that Independent as a newspaper was the voice of sanity in UK, in the United Kingdom. But over time, Independent saw its circulation dwindling, and ultimately it reached the rock bottom of just 40,000 paid subscribers. Now imagine a brand which is more than 5 decades old in that part of the world. What does it do? Surprise, they decided to take a hard decision. They decided to kill Independent as a brand in print and launched Independent as essentially a web and mobile product. Within a year of its launch, it has generated an audience of over 1 million unique visitors, and has turned almost profitable. So this is an interesting example of a digital-only brand. And I'm also aware of the fact that some of the premium broadcasters in India, despite the show of bravado, with the kind of investments that have got sunk in the business, are feeling the pinch of money. And my question to Shaunil is, are you looking at bolstering? I'm not going to ask you to say that, are you looking at a mobile only space, because that could be counterintuitive at this point of time. But are you looking at bolstering the Times Now presence in this space so that you can look at enhancing your reach and reducing your, you know, reducing your costs?
So Sanjay, you know, coming from Times, this is a, you know, a problem we grapple with continuously. It's been going on for the last couple of years, because these are massive legacy players in print and outdoor and huge inventory in magazines and newsprint and multiple languages, etc. Luckily for us here in India, unlike the Independent in the UK, which ran into trouble quite abruptly, this is a gradual movement. So, you know, for us, we're in a good space because our traditional brands, including the brands on broadcast, etc., are still growing, but not as fast as they were maybe 5-6 years ago. And we're being able to complement this by new digital platforms, which is essentially on mobile. So, you know, a lot of you consume news, by the time you pick up the newspaper, the next day it actually feels like yesterday's news. But there's still a huge amount of people in India who don't mind reading yesterday's news. So we are catering to both these segments. We're trying to give instant news out to people who are on their mobiles and who want to stay continuously updated. But then the parent company and the broadcasting unit are catering to a lot of the audiences which are still consuming digital media. So we're at a cusp right now. I know mobile is important. I know more people are moving there, and it worries us at times. But so we are trying to bolster our, you know, our traditional businesses with a whole host of mobile offerings.
Maheep, the question is, where is the money in mobile? That I think is already getting answered, at least from your perspective. Would you share, or would you be able to share actually, the intention of Flipkart to spend more monies on mobile with a view to garner more revenues? So I'm saying that since the customer has already moved on to this platform and the response is now visible and calibrated, are the marketing dollars or are the marketing rupees shifting in that kind of a proportion to this medium?
Well, at an overall level, if you ask me, I think ATL will still be, on a higher side. However, if you talk specifically on digital and if I just talk on performance, I think we continue to invest, and acquire new users month on month. It has never stopped, right? We are close to, I think, 200 million installs today just on Play Store Android. But what happens essentially is you need to, keep the traffic coming on, right? There'll be users who would, come to you, stay with you, and also, uninstall the app, right? App specifically, I think, we are investing heavily and we will continue to invest. However, there is a lot of, intentions in terms of how do you get new set of customers after, almost e-com shoppers are already there on your platform, right? So I think that is one of the challenges that we face. But I think on mobile-specific investments in terms of branding as well as in terms of performance, I think we are very focused of, keep doing it because there is a direct value proportion. Specifically, I would say that in Tier 2 cities, the focus will still be on because we see a lot of potential there.
I think you touched an important point about not just customer acquisition but customer retention. And you did talk about building engagement. We've seen that mobile as a medium is being driven essentially tactically these days, and no long-term community building efforts, barring some smart FMCG brands like Levers, for instance, are actually doing a good job in terms of building community-based engagement on the space. Vinay, you are 95% of your audience comes from mobile. You are not sitting in the mainstream cities of India. Language is where the next growth of internet is predicted to come in from. So my question to you is, do you see a marriage between languages and mobile happening? And how do you see the space exploding?
So I think mobile and language are hand in hand stories in India, right? They are the whole language space became relevant because of mobile, because on desktop language was never so big, right? Because we were limited to the 30 to 50 million premium so to say audience in India, which usually speaks English, which is in the metros, and that's about it. But then first mobile happened, and then of course, Jio happened, and then all of a sudden, this huge audience of almost 500 million now in India on internet, which carries this supercomputer in their pocket every day, and they don't know what to do with it. Frankly, the only thing that they don't know is to consume content, and not to be disrespectful to the audience, but I was sitting with a Bollywood director luckily a couple of days ago, and he was telling me a story of the 90s when they were making very serious movies, and then and this is a very famous director. They then three of them gathered and they said, this is not working out. How do you make something mass? And then they used one term. They said we need to dumb it down. So when you create mass, you have to basically dumb it down the same way. And in content also, this whole 500 million audience is in language. They don't understand English, of course. English is not it natural to them. There is no common language, which is why regional has become so huge. And the content also that they're consuming is non-serious in nature, which was another reason that when we were building our brand, we took a stance that news is not where we want to be. One, because of the nature of the beast and because of the whole thing. And also, the audience, the larger audience is coming online, frankly, not to consume news, but to literally kill their boredom. They have a lot of time on their hand. And because as Chen was also saying that, you know, the device is so personal. It's always there with you. Another reference, I'm sure you all must have seen Elon Musk, that famous interview where he smoked the weed and all that stuff, right? He said something about mobiles. Mobiles are extension of our bodies today. You know, and this whole typing that we do on mobile, through which we communicate to mobile, is a medium of exchange of information between the mobile and our body. And very soon that medium is going to change. What I mean is voice is one example of that. But very soon we are going to be actually connected to this. We probably will have, you know, our skin will become the screen and so on and so forth. Imagine the world where, you know, we will stop talking about mobile before we know it. And it's all going to be, so digital is going to be the word that is going to carry forward, not mobile. And language, and it's going to be very personal. So language is also, for me, language is a subset of personalization. So how well you can be relevant to the audience. If you start to solve that question, language becomes an answer to that question automatically. That if you want to talk to that customer or that consumer or that user does not understand English, so you have to speak their language. And language is also not about just the language like the English, Hindi, that. It's also about the tonality, the way you use it. You have to speak in their terminology itself.
I think you talked about tonality, and as a side, some of the people in the audience who may not know about the Lalan Top must visit Lalan Top to see how they're leveraging Hindi and how they're getting the tenor and tonality of Hindi so right to look at, capturing audiences in the tier 2, tier 3 towns of the middle India. So do visit Lalan Top. Absolutely fascinating product which has come in from... Okay,
Sanjay, so... I have, because you said Lalan Top, I have an example, I have a reference to add to that. We just signed up this guy. His name is Charles Bihari Lal. He's an Australian. He lives he's living in India for the last 25 years. He speaks amazing Bhojpuri. So we signed him to do a show with us on the Hindi property. We'll be building a show, talk show with him, where Charles Bihari Lal hosts guests, and, you know, we'll be talking about topics relevant to the northern part of India, the Hindi-speaking belt, basically. So that's how local you have to get when you get there.
Absolutely. You know, this space is evolving, and it's full of exciting possibilities. Now, I would like to focus a little bit on some of the key challenges the current marketers are facing. In terms of, we painted a pretty interesting picture in terms of the possibilities and how mobile is getting increasing acceptance. But from your perspective, Jahid, what are the key challenges that you faced, or are you facing any challenges at all?
Yeah, lots of them. First, we are a legacy bank, right? So language, we love to do language. But then language only, the creative is language. He comes in, the call center is talking in English. So there is a fractured approach over there, right? Second, the mindset has to change of the organization. People have to wait that a brand over a mobile will take time. There's a difference between impact property and building up a brand. So if I have to create an impact advertisement, I can just paint the red, paint the city blue and just create an impact out over there. But if I have to slowly, you know, be a part of the customer's journey from the exploratory phase. See, he's not getting up in the morning to buy a financial product. He's getting up in the morning to fulfill one of his dreams. Financial product is just an aid to fulfill his dreams, right? So how can I be a part of his journey when he's trying to explore what dream he has to fulfill, right? So that takes time. So the mindset has to wait that, you know, via language, via content, it'll take time, but it'll slowly and steadily build up the brand. Third is the whole creative set. You know, people talk about mobile day in, day out, but people fail. They still make a creative which is vertical and not portrait. They still make creatives, which is desktop first, and then we will say, okay, ab isko responsive bana do. Okay, so I think these are the challenges that we face continuously, where people talk about it, but the whole mindset, the DNA has to change throughout, be it the customer's point of view, be it the organization's point of view, where each and everybody, be it the brand team, be it the CFO, be it the CMO, they all have to be patient and they all have to come in a very collaborative way to understand that mobile will succeed, the languages will succeed, but yes, we have to give it time to succeed.
Yeah, please.
So I think also once you do that entire... end on your side of the thing, the mobile itself changes. So the technology itself is going. So you're going to go and get the right creative for an Instagram or for like a Snapchat, and then they'll open a vertical video because technology itself will change and more phones are coming into the market and, you know, they keep experimenting with their own technology. So I think one of the bigger challenges is also how are you going to always catch up with this first medium, which is personal, without, and you can't do that without having enough resources. And to have enough resources on mobile, you need to have enough metrics or results that have proved the worth of those resources in the first place. So I think that's a bigger challenge because, again, from a thinking perspective, it has to be thought mobile first.
One of the challenges that I can probably bring to the panel is the call to action. I mean, once you sort of have a mobile campaign that's running for any product or any campaign that you're running, we as Indians, I may be wrong, but we like to talk. We like to speak. We need to voice our opinion. We need to talk to a human at the other end. So when it's a call to action, which essentially is a chatbot or an artificial intelligence tool that's communicating with you, there is no personalized feel to that whole engagement. So even though you are on your mobile, you've been chatting with your friends on WhatsApp, where you have a connect and hence you can establish that relationship, the mobile restricts you from getting into that actual engagement or a personalized communication, which is an effective call to action to finally get into a transaction, right? I mean, all of us here, having said whatever we've said, we essentially want to make money and do business on mobile. But unless there is an effective call to action tool which personalizes the experience and the engagement with the consumer, whatever brand, product, service that you're selling, is not effective enough to communicate your query, your question to the audience or to answer their queries, I think it's going to be ineffective to sort of build that bridge between the consumer and the brand.
Would you like to respond?
Yeah, so I'm just on a chatbot, right? I think if you've observed, Facebook has an allowed chatbot notification to each user, right? And now today, let's say a brand, right? I'll just take an example of, for example, I was with Big Basket earlier. Now, if let's say 2 person is speaking on a chat and you have allowed a chatbot to, listen to your conversation in between, a bot will come in between and he can actually suggest groceries to you, right? If you start talking to a chatbot, depending on your query that you have built it at the back end, it can actually lead to a transaction. And if you just read, there are like various blogs how brands are actually leveraging that. I would say it was not very successful for us in terms of transaction, but at least for any new guy who actually doesn't know about a brand, at least you are going and telling them, hey, there is something, or there is something which is available for you as a solution, right?
On the bots part, because I think with HDFC Bank, we have developed one of the most successful bots, okay, and going to the transactional space also. We've also got, I think, one of the first banks to come with on Alexa as well as Google Assistant. Till the time your backend is fixed, no AI, no NLP can help you. So our backend has to be fixed because your offers have to be streamlined, because AI and NLP is just a tool to read it properly and then kind of learn over it over a period of time. So that's very important.
Great. So we talked about, I'm coming to you on a specific question because we've talked about challenges which would include the task orientation, the lack of mobile specific creatives in terms of communication. You will look at challenges of building engagement. Now, one of the key challenges, the custom content, which is bespoke content for mobile. And Rujita, since your core audience is the farming community and they would be more conversant with the various vernacular languages, are you seeing some movement in your company towards custom content creation for them?
Yes, absolutely. In fact, we've already started the journey a while ago. All my websites are responsive and are in 9 languages. All the content that we create for social media has to go in several languages, which is being 9 languages to cater to different states. The next step we're looking at is actually getting into the hyper-local content piece of it, wherein a person will get localized content which he can comprehend and relate to from his relevant state and from the relevant geography that he comes from. So this is where we are getting at, and it's a fairly complicated and complex task to achieve. The other challenge that we need to really cater to is the comprehension levels of these audiences. With the changing speed of changes that happen in digital, for them to catch up and try to understand how to use certain applications is a huge challenge. So it's like a new everyday learning for them. This also dissuades them from engaging a lot more with applications. The other bit is it has to be supplemented with on-ground experiences. So this sort of completes the entire journey.
Absolutely. We are already overshot our time. But before I come to the audience, I think one of the key things for us as students of the space is to appreciate that no specific medium is actually going to call the shots. In fact, Satya Nadella has already talked about the age of the super platform. And this is going to be a converged space where you're looking at multiple platforms coming together. And depending on the consumer proclivity or the consumer movement or consumer preference, these platforms are going to coalesce and will create a seamless experience. So any company which is looking at essentially pivoting to generating compelling consumer experiences, moving from winning in mobile to moving to winning in experiences will actually leverage the space. With this, I would like now to invite the audience to shoot their questions. Please identify yourself and also ask your question to a specific panelist, if you have any queries. And if there are no questions, then we can give you some time. Sorry, I didn't see a hand there. Yep.
Yeah, hi, I'm Varun. I'm working in Vodafone Idea. So, a lot of you said about brands being built on mobile. So essentially, from what I understand, it's a smartphone you're talking about. Mr. Rahul, who said that he's still dependent on the SMS as a medium for his communication. So what about the non-smartphone users? How have you thought about building your brand to them? Because in India, still, we are a very big market for the 2G phones and the feature phones. How are you thinking about building your business to those customers? We're still far away from being a complete 4G base. How do we go about that?
I think great question on feature phones. So out of 500 million, we still have only 200 million, a little less than 200 million smartphones. There is a 60% of the audience still on feature phones. Who would like to take this question? Vinay, we try and address.
I may not have the right answer to this, but the way we look at it, see, businesses are built on the future, not on the past. Feature phone, whatever may be the reality, that there may be a few million feature phone users out there, but they are not going to be in a couple of years or a few years. And I'll give you an example from my house. My father used to be a feature phone guy forever in his life. And last year, he switched to a smartphone. And I don't think you can take his phone away from him now. It's not possible. Because he's hooked to Facebook, to WhatsApp, and he's connected with his community. And it's my father and mother both, actually. And, probably I don't know if both of them chat to each other on WhatsApp or not. But point being, it's not possible to take that away, and that conversion is happening really, really fast. So you don't build your business for something that is going out. It's not an incoming technology. It's not outgoing technology.
I think for some of us where part of our top line still comes from there, we can't take that view. But I think for feature phones, there are a host of things we can do. So there are caller tunes that are still in place. There are prepaid cards where, you know, you can add on a service to a particular prepaid card where you can also offer a discount to them if they were to have a particular call to action. So, you know, you have to think again out of the box because it's a very, very niche population. So how you think niche premium, you have to think super niche feature. And how much of radio they are listening on their phone, how much of, you know, so for Benadryl, for example, we push caller tunes, we push ringtones, literally ringtones to mass population. So I think the more, as long as you are still able to reach them three times a day, because the feature phone also allows you to do that, you should be able to try and use the mechanics of that phone.
Maybe one last question before we close. Yep.
Hi, my name is Raj Gopal. I'm from Chroma. This question is for Mahi from Flipkart. What percentage of your revenues come from mobile? So there was this talk of you guys being only mobile. So is that thought still persists, or you guys have given up that thought?
So almost 90% is mobile, and that would include mobile app and mWeb essentially.
So it's really huge. Is it a thought of being only on mobile? Is that thought still persists, or you given up that thought?
I didn't get you. Can you please repeat?
I mean, there was this thought and there was a talk saying that you guys will only be on mobile.
So I think earlier there was a strategy where I think Myntra also adopted and Flipkart also was one of them. But I think you can't take desktop away from people in India, right? I think even I am a heavy mobile user, but whenever I'm at work or, you know, anybody who is at a workplace, essentially in metros, or if you go back even in tier 2 cities where there are still desktops available, right? I think that 7-8% or a 10% is still a higher GMV to you today apart from a mobile app. And I think that's a decision which has been taken by a company where we figured out that, you know, until we still get traction on web, I think let's keep it.
Just to add on to this also, people are using mobile to explore, but there's a lot of huge segment of people when it's coming to transactions, they still depend on desktops.
I will just add, right, and I think great insight. So I was with Big Basket earlier, and our GMV or let's say a basket value on desktop is still heavier than the mobile phone, right? What Big Basket essentially does today is, if you go on an app, there's a smart basket, right? Whenever you keep buying, they keep adding the products, and it is right, I think, on a second tile today. What essentially it does is when you remember that you want to, let's say, buy only, I think, sugar or potato or any of the vegetables, you'll just buy it online because you are on the go, you are in hurry, you'll just buy, check out and go. The smart basket actually reminds you that, you know, you need to probably order something more, right? And I think that is like one of the examples which tells me that e-com can be, you know, one of the players which is heavy on mobile, but I think desktop will still play a very, very vital role.
Great. With this, we call it a wrap. And audience, thank you for your patience. And panelists, it's been a fascinating conversation. Thanks for your insights. Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much indeed to all of our panelists. I'm going to request you all to please remain on the stage. And may I please request our session moderator, Mr. Sanjay Trehan, to please present the mementos to all of our speakers as well. We're going to request our speakers to please remain on the stage for a group photograph as well. Meanwhile, ladies and gentlemen, we're also going to march ahead with our next session. So I'm going to request all of you to please be seated. Also keep those tweets coming because now we're going to be announcing our first winner of the Twitter contest in just a couple of seconds. So keep those tweets coming using hashtag ScreenAge.